Hello and welcome to Fruitful Living. We're so glad that you've joined in with us today, and we're going to take you into one of the very special life coaching sessions that we hosted here in the area where we live. Carol and I have been involved in life coaching with youth and young adults and families for well over 20 years. And we're going to take you into one of those moments, share it with you so that you can hear some of the things that God is bringing through His Word to people that live in the urban community. We'll be back at the conclusion of today's session just to pray with you. God bless you.
Boy, woo! We've fought all the way to the wedding. We sat in the car, still fighting. We missed the wedding. Everybody went over to the reception. They had the reception at a different place. So we drove over to where the reception was going to be, you know, where they're going to eat and dance and all of them. We're sitting in the parking lot. We're still going at it. And finally, my wife said, just take me home. See, everybody, y'all all know, just take me home. And I didn't have the nerve to keep talking. Still trying to make my point of the importance of the work that I do. And the priority of the work that I do. And that I'm not saying that you're less, but I just couldn't get away. And my wife said it one more time, just take me home. So I shut up and I took her home. Not a word spoken. I'm sure some of you have been through that, where you drive all the way home and you say nothing. We get home and we say nothing. That's the silence of those moments. It's nothing but the car turning off. Boom. Boom. Footsteps. Key in the door. Open the door. Both go in the door. Boom. Y'all understand the silence of those moments. I'm giving you all the sound effects so you can feel. She goes to the bedroom. I just go to a whole nother part of the house. Even the children know something's wrong because mom and dad aren't saying nothing. The whole house goes quiet. You hear nothing but the television. Television playing and our sons playing video games. It's the only, they not even talking. They just playing, but nobody's saying anything. You know it's something when even the children go quiet. And usually when they're playing games, you know, they're trash talking with each other the whole time, but nobody's saying anything. We had gotten home like 2 o'clock in the afternoon and went the whole day. Nobody saying anything. So around 11 o'clock at night, when you're forced to go into the bedroom together, because you got to go to bed. And one thing that we had never done was to sleep separately, even if we were having a fight. It's just that you sleep on the extreme side of the bed. Y'all know, almost hanging off the edge. Because I don't even want your pajamas to rub up against my pajamas. We got two people on either side of a king-size bed. I did not know how to resolve this. And I don't know why you come to these moments in our lives, and I just feel like that this is an integral part of what God wants to do in Harrisburg. I guess that's why I'm telling you this story. Because we all come to moments where it's just an impasse. My wife is absolutely right in that as my wife, she should have priority. But at the same time, I was right, and many people have been there. When you're on a job, you can't just pick up and just walk out the door at any time that you want, unless it's an emergency. This was an urgency, but it wasn't an emergency. We were both right. So how could we deal with this impasse? I did not know what to say. She had already made it clear that she didn't want me to say anything else. We had been silent at that point at least 8 or 9 hours. But in a way to break the ice just came to me. And this is the advantage of having a relationship with God, of having the Spirit of God living inside of you. The purpose of God living inside of us is not for us to go around boasting and being proud and arrogant like so many Christians have been. The reason for this relationship with the Lord is so that we could deal with times like this, when you don't know what to say, when you are both right from your points of view. That's the reason for the relationship with God and having the Spirit of God living inside of us. Because the Lord brought this thought to my mind, and literally I was saying it even as I was thinking. I said, "Dear, I want to lose this fight." And I watched my wife's shoulders. She always laughs. I watched her shoulders come down. She went, and I want to lose this fight. All I want, I just need to be able to tell you how I feel. And I need you to tell me if what I'm saying, if that's what's really happening. What do you see? What is it from your perspective? Because for what we both were trying to say is, I need you to listen to me. I need to have permission to at least express where I am. Isn't that why so many people are frustrated? Some of us are like that. All of our childhood has been that way. Parents, dad, mom, grandma, grandpa, aunts, uncles, it was always shut up, shut up, shut up, shut up, sit down, shut up. And you never had the right to express yourself. And if you did, woo, that's the last time I'm gonna do that. Then you hit the teenage years and you do begin to express yourself and you find out that a whole lot of people don't like what your expression. You don't know as a teenager that it really doesn't matter what everybody thinks. But because that's your world when you're a teenager, other people's opinion, the way people view you. So you take some chances and say a little bit of how you feel or what you think. And there's always somebody to cut it down. So when you become a young adult, you know the game. You know how to present yourself one way. But inside, you're another way. You know how to say the right things, but inside, that's really not where you are. So we live conflicted. Then when you get into a relationship with someone who seemingly understands, finally you start opening up and saying some of those things that you never told anybody else, and he or she gets it, and they get you. And they understand, and they laugh, and you share the same things in common. But then as the relationship goes, you start running into the differences. And then when this person who you gave your heart to begins to reject what you have to say, then it feels all the way back like it did when mama and daddy and grandma and grandpa and cutthroats and folks who was hypocrites and phonies, the way they treated you. So now you feel like your own spouse or your boyfriend or girlfriend or the one who's closest to you, you're doing the same thing. So in that moment, the Lord gave me the wisdom. I want to lose this fight. This isn't about winning and losing. I want us to win. It's not important that I win this fight, win this argument. I want us to win. I believe that's what God wants for Urban Life Church. He wants us to win. I believe that that's what God wants in you and my heart and our families, for us to win. Is it more important that I win that argument or win my wife? I wanted to win my wife. She wanted to win her husband. What we discovered was that we were both right. I like using this example. In fact, I'll use this projector as an example, and I'll say to you, you know, guys, this projector, it has a emblem on it. And you guys will go, ain't no emblem on that. I don't see no emblem. All I see is a wire sticking out the back. Well, see, from my perspective, that's what I see. And from your perspective, that's what you see. We're both looking at the same object, but from different perspectives. There are people who are arguing and fighting over denominations and doctrines and teachings and all kind of stuff. And basically, we're looking at the same thing from different perspective. And what God is trying to do is raise up a people who will, would you come over here and look at it from my side for a moment? And you'll see that I'm right. And when I come over and look at it from your side, I'll see that you are right. We were both right about what we were looking at. We were just looking at it from different perspective. And you're gonna find that if we as a people can move into that, God's going to do something mighty in our families, in our homes. This is part of what it's going to take to rebuild and renew and restore hearts and homes in Harrisburg. I'll close with this story. Many years ago, after church one Sunday, as church people do, we always go out to eat. In fact, in an hour or so, restaurants will be filled in Harrisburg as church people get out, as churches let out, and Cracker Barrel and Peachtree and everything's going to be filled up with church folks, because that's what we do. We go out to eat after church. And so we went to a smorgasbord type of place, all you can eat, and we were just sitting there eating, and people from all different kinds of churches there, because, you know, I was sitting at all these different tables, pretty nice-sized restaurant. Really, really big place. But as we were eating, over in the far corner to my left, I heard somebody choking. And it was a very clear and distinct sound. My family, the sound of choking is very sensitive in our family because my mom lost her youngest child due to a choking accident while she was pregnant with me. Her 2-year-old son died by choking. And so the sound of choking is very serious in my family. My wife can tell you, if anybody even cough wrong, my whole family just, it's almost like a knee-jerk reaction for us. So I heard this person choking, and I just jumped up and ran over to that side of the room. Didn't even give it a second thought, just ran over there. And the table was already in a panic as this woman was sitting there gagging, kids were crying, adults were starting to scramble and start screaming. And so I ran behind the woman. I was trying to lift her up so that I could pick her up to do the Heimlich maneuver. And she was a little too big for me. And all of a sudden, there's this other young man from somebody, from somewhere else, another table, came over, and we both helped. He helped me lift her up, and then he got behind her, and he did it and dislodged the food. And everybody just burst into tears, crying and thank you and all of that. And I came back to the table and my wife just hugged me and she was so proud of me. I didn't even think about it in the moment, but I share this with you to let you in on a little bit of insight about your pastors and about your leaders. It was not important in that moment what church that woman went to. What church she went to, what she believed, what was her doctrinal stance on tithing, what she believed about the Holy Spirit or baptism, none of that mattered. Me and that young man didn't come over to that girl and go, "So do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?" "So where do you stand on tithing? Do you believe in being baptized in the Holy Ghost? Are you Protestant or Catholic?" But yet, as ridiculous as that sounds, that's what's going on in Harrisburg today. There are people who are choking. Their lives have fallen apart. Wives have left, husbands have left, close friends have cheated, they've lost their jobs. Foreclosures, bankruptcy. They're choking. Meanwhile, churches and pastors are, "So what do you believe about Jesus? Repent!" While people are choking. So what we're far more interested in is helping people to get what's choking them out first. It doesn't matter if whether they join our church. After we helped save that girl's life, I didn't pass her a card and said, "Now be sure to attend Metro Christian Worship Center, because that's where I work at that church, and remember who it was that helped save you." It doesn't matter if rather they join Urban Life Church. I just want them to stop choking. I want them to know what it's like to have a great relationship with your wife. I see so many guys walking around Harrisburg, 40 years old, 50 years old, still trying to, they still think they got it. I'll put it that way. And they think because the little girls are running up to them that it's because they look good. But it's because, brother, you still got a job. You got some money. That's why she's after you. It ain't because you still got it. Yeah, shave your head like I do. Put in an earring, and when it starts to grow back gray, sister girl knows it. You got one pack, not six pack. You got one pack, and it really is a barrel, complete with handles. I'm in my 50s now. There's just certain things. Me and my wife joke about it all the time now. It's hard to come to that reality that you're not 24 anymore. You're just not. I see so many men here in Harrisburg trying to hold on to their youth. I'm not saying this to put them down, but I want you to understand they're choking. They're still trying to hold on to yesterday. because when they were in their 20s, I didn't have this kind of money. I wasn't living in no place like this. I didn't have my own place, my own car. And so now I'm 50 and I got it. I got all the stuff that I wanted back when I was in my 20s. And now they're trying to live the 20s life. And sorry, dude, you can't do it. So we're after the choking. What is it that's causing the family to choke, the brothers to choke? Here is where all of us or a family fits in. Just like in that moment, I needed somebody to help me to lift this woman up. That's what Urban Life Church is. Because a pastor can't do it by himself. I need some people that's going to help. We all get to be a part of lifting people up and getting them delivered. Thank you, Lord. So come on, right now in this moment, in fact, you may be in the place where you're saying, Lord, I need deliverance myself before I try to help anybody else. So would you be honest with God right now and say that? Just really, that's what it's really about. Lord, I need the help. I realize that I'm choking. Thank you, Lord. I'm choking. Thank you, Lord. And that's where it begins. You just be honest about where you are. Lord, I need the help. Life ain't going right. Situations ain't going right. Yes, Lord. Some are choking on bad relationships. Some are choking on debt. Some are choking on shattered dreams, expectations, things that never came to pass. Some are choking, God, because they've been betrayed. It's a lot of betrayal. You've been betrayed. You gave your heart to someone. They told you they would never leave. You made commitments and covenant together. We're going to do this. We're going to build a life together. We're going to get there. And none of that has happened. So it's left you choking. So would you in this moment just say, Lord, here's my life. Just right. Be real honest with God. Lord, here I am. I give every disappointment to you. Thank you, Lord. I give my heart to you. I'm not saying, in this moment, I'm not telling you guys to try to join this church. That's not what's important. I'm not telling you to pray a prayer to join this church. Just commit your heart to the Lord. Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my life. I'm tired of choking on all this stuff in my life, so I give it to you. Thank you, Lord. Don't try to make no deals and bargains with God right now. Sometimes you can feel like, Lord, I don't really want to make this step because I'm not really sure I can live this Christian life and really do all this stuff. I ain't telling you to do all that. Don't make no deals and bargains. Just take it a step at a time. Lord, here's my heart. Here's my life. I give it to you. I turn away from all of my own efforts to try to put my life together, keep my life together. I just give it to you. I give it to you, Lord. I give my life to you. I give my heart to you. I open up my heart. Come on in, Lord. Do just what you said in your word. That if I just turn away from my own way, if I believe you, if I receive you, then I would be your child. You would come to live in me. My life would be yours. So I do that right now. My life is yours. Thank you, Lord. For those of you that already have a relationship with the Lord, would you make this commitment to him? Lord, I'm going to be a part. I'm going to be a part of helping this ministry to lift people up, those who are choking, to lift them up and get them out of that position of choking. Lord, show us how to spiritually do the Heimlich maneuver to get that out, that thing that's caught them, that's taken away their breath and their life. Thank you, Lord. Right now, don't think about some busy work or anything that you can do for the church, but just commit your heart to Him right now. Just, Lord, I'm listening to You. I make this commitment to really to listen to You and to do what You're telling me each day. Thank You, Lord. Lord, show me how to, for all the men that are married in the room, just, Lord, show me how to love my wife. How to love my kids. For all the wives, just, Lord, show me how to respect my husband. Show me how to love my kids.
Wasn't that just such a special word, such an incredible word for us to hear and to receive for our lives today? Even though it was recorded quite some time ago, it still amazes us how those coaching sessions and those lessons still apply even today in our lives. Lord, we thank You for this awesome privilege that You have given us to share this word with people here locally, nationally, and even around the world, the things that You want to do in the lives of Your people so that we can truly be fruitful in every way. We pray that this word touches every heart and every home. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you, and we look forward to being with you again next time here on Fruitful Living.